Well, good morning, everyone, and welcome to our webinar. Today, we're going to be discussing search engine optimization and pay-per-click, otherwise known as SEO and PPC. We want to talk about best practices and really define those for everyone with a focus on how do we generate new patients from our digital marketing efforts. So we'll start out with a little bit of background information about WEO and digital marketing in general, moving really quickly into really how do search engines work and understanding the fundamentals around websites and search engines. We'll spend most of the webinar getting into the details of SEO and PPC, and we'll have some case studies throughout. My background briefly, so I'm one of the co-founders, partner at WEO Media. We are a dental marketing agency based in Portland, Oregon. In the dental industry, we've really spent a lot of time doing a deep dive and getting really knowledgeable about specifically how does this work? How does this digital marketing thing work for dentistry? I've been pretty fortunate. Dentistry Today has named me one of their top CE leaders and consultants for the last 3 years, and that's been a nice little honor. I appreciated that. When we talk about WEO, we're really talking dental. All we do is dental. We work with hundreds of practices all over North America. And as I mentioned, we're based in Portland, Oregon. We founded the company in 2009. And really since about 2011, we've just exclusively focused on dentistry. So we really have a deep understanding of what we're doing here. Last real quick thing about us. We've been very fortunate to win the ADA's Best of Class Award 4 years in a row for being the top website and online marketing company. And that's a pretty big honor. It's kind of the biggest award in the industry for what we do. So we're pretty excited to have won that 4 times in a row. Okay, that's enough about us. Just wanted to give you a little bit of that background. Today, we're going to talk about digital marketing. Now, when we talk about digital marketing, we teach courses all around the country. A lot of times we'll talk about the 6 pillars of online marketing. Websites, SEO and PPC, online reputation, social media, and videos. Now, today, we're just going to talk about pillars 2 and 3 in particular. Let's start with a kind of a cursory understanding about websites and search engines. This information is really kind of necessary to build a foundation for us to really get into the details a little bit more advanced level for SEO and PPC. So let's start with a website. What is a website? Well, we all know what a website is, right? We see the doctor picture here. We see navigation bar, text, and images. And that's a website. You know, we all know what that is, right? Well, this is also the same website. Now, on the left, that's what human beings look at, right? That's what we see. Now, on the right, this is code. This is called HTML website code. This is what search engines look at. And so when you think about, you know, how does Google determine how to rank your website, there are actually many, many things. And we'll get into specifically how Google does that. But one thing you need to understand right out of the gate is Google doesn't look at the website like you and I look at it. Google reads the code, as does Yahoo and Bing and other search engines. And in fact, this one page on the website is 544 lines of code, not the entire website, just the first page. So when you've got a website of, you know, 30, 40, 50 pages of content, you're literally talking probably tens of thousands of lines of programming code. So it's really important when we build websites to understand we've got two distinct audiences and they're quite different, right? People, we look at the typical websites and search engines are looking at the code. As we go through the SEO conversation in particular, we're going to kind of talk about both of these audiences and keeping both in mind because they care about different things and both things matter. You know, we have to appeal to people first and foremost, right? So how do we do that? Well, if we think about, you know, what are the features of a website that people kind of care most about? Well, the design and layout, right? Is it modern and professional looking? Does the content educate and inform us? Is it easy to use and navigate, right? And ultimately, it should have good information. Why should we choose you? Ultimately, we want people to be able to contact us and encourage them to take the next step to communicate with us, whether it's call us for an appointment, send us an email, request an appointment, 24/7 live chat. There's lots of ways that that website can engage with people. So really, we want to educate them, engage them, and then encourage them to take that next step. That's really what the website should be doing as far as people are concerned. Now, let's look at this list for search engines. Search engines care about a very different set of criteria. I'm not going to go through all of these. We'll cover a lot of this stuff later in the SEO section, but I want to talk about these first two bullets in particular. This first one is called unique content. So what is that? Well, let's say, you know, you go to a dental conference and there's like a dozen companies who will sell you a website. You buy a website from them and they, you know, they throw it up on the internet and they're typically going to have what we call stock content, meaning the content that they use to describe, you know, veneers and bridges and crowns and dental implants and orthodontics and all these dental services, it's the same exact content that resides on many of their other client websites. That's duplicate content. While that's fine for audience number one, people understand the context of that. it's not good for search engines. Search engines much prefer and heavily prefer unique content, meaning it was written solely and only for your website. Google rewards content that is written uniquely. And so if you have unique content on your website, it is a huge advantage to get you ranking in search engines. I'll give you kind of an example. This is kind of a goofy example that I like to use with people to illustrate the point. So let's pretend for a minute that I'm a dentist and I place dental implants, okay? And, you know, we all understand what a dental implant is, right? Titanium screw, osseointegration, all that stuff. So let's just make up some nonsense content for my website. Let's just say I make my own implants. I make them out of aluminum foil. I roll them up into little cylinders and I just whack them into somebody's mouth with a mallet, right? Total nonsense, you know, crazy talk, right? Now, if I wrote that down as content on my website, it would obviously be unique because it's crazy. But what's interesting about that unique content could actually outrank your content that's technically and clinically correct about, you know, titanium screw, osseointegration, abutments, crowns, all this good stuff. But if that content exists on a bunch of other websites, my crazy aluminum foil content could actually rank higher than you in a Google search. Now, there are many other things that affect how you rank in a Google search, but that's just one of those examples where Google will reward unique content over duplicate content because a lot of times it can't really tell if it's factually correct or clinically correct in our case. So it's really looking at uniqueness. Now, the second thing on here that search engines care about that people don't typically tend to care about as much is having one topic per page. It's really common on a dental website. I'll just take a general dentistry website, for example. Services, we have crowns and bridges and inlays and onlays and ortho and implants and all these things, right? Restorative and preventative and so forth. You'd list all those things on a services page. And to audience number one, people, we understand the context of that. We understand, oh, okay, this is a list of the services provided by this dental practice. Got it, no problem. Well, to a search engine, it looks at that, it says, okay, there's a lot of topics on this page. It's not about any one particular thing. Therefore, I'm not going to rank it for any one particular thing because there's not really any useful content here. So while it's fine to kind of list things out on like a general list of categories, here's all the things we provide. In addition to that, you need to have one page, at least one page of each topic. So one page on bridges, one page on veneers, one page on crowns and so forth. Anything you want to rank for in a Google search, you should have at least one unique page of content for each one of those. Now, if it's a thing that's particular focus, like let's say you focus a lot on dental implants, you probably want to have at least a half a dozen unique pages related to dental implants. So there are lots of things like that we can do to get a website ranking really highly, but it's got to start with unique content. If you're paying somebody for SEO and they're not writing unique content for your website, you're not getting SEO. It's just as simple as that. So those are just a couple of high-level differences between search engines and people. Now, let's get into SEO a little more deeply. What is it, first of all? Search engine optimization. It's essentially an ongoing process. What we do is we look at things on the website itself, which we call on page, and there are things away from the website, which we call off page. Now, these things have to be done on a monthly basis, and I'll explain why in a minute. But there's a variety of things that Google looks at holistically to determine how high to rank your business on a search. And so it's going to look for things that it can find on your website itself and then things away from the website as well. These things must be done on an ongoing basis in order to rank high and maintain a high ranking. So before we dig in super deep, let's kind of set the context for what are we really talking about here? When we talk about SEO and PPC, what does that mean on a search? So on the left of the screen here, I've just got a screenshot of a search. This would be a Google search searching for a dentist in Portland, Oregon, which is where we're based. So at the very top left, I just outlined it in blue. Those are the PPC ads, pay-per-click ads. So these are paid ads. People are paying money to show up in those spots, okay? Below that, outlined in green, those are the organic results determined by search engine optimization performance. In there, you've got kind of a map, local map section, which is typically three or four listings. And then below that, typically there are about 10 organic listings. So collectively, the organic results get about 94% of the clicks on page one, and the pay-per-click ads get about 6%. Now, before you discount pay-per-clicks, oh, 6% of the ads, or 6% of the clicks, no big deal. Pay-per-click ads can be a huge deal. They can be very, very effective if they're implemented properly. What do I mean by that? Well, I'm going to give you a little example here. So I've outlined Anaheim, California. So this is Southern California, right? Now, this little star here, let's just pretend that that's my dental practice, right? I'm placing my aluminum foil implants and just begging for a lawsuit because I'm a terrible dentist. So let's pretend this is my practice right here. Okay, this is my star. And so in most practices, right, you're going to pull 80% of your patients from probably, you know, a 5, 6, 7 mile radius, maybe 10 mile radius, whatever the case may be. But let's just say 80% of my patients are coming from inside that circle, okay, which is probably pretty realistic. Now, how does SEO and PPC play into this scenario? The way search engines work, if you're a local business, it focuses on local search, meaning local search for your specific city. So as you can see on the map here, I have an Anaheim address. My physical address is Anaheim. So for when it comes to Google search, I can typically rank in organic search results for searches related to Anaheim, dentist Anaheim, cosmetic dentist Anaheim, dental implants Anaheim, and so forth, right? So that's where SEO could help me rank. But what about Fullerton, Buena Park, Cypress, Stanton, Garden Grove, like all these other cities and little communities right around my practice that are not actually Anaheim? How am I going to show up in a Google search for those? Because local search, as long as there are enough dentists in those towns, like if I'm in Fullerton and I type dentist Fullerton, it's going to show me a bunch of dentists in Fullerton. Why would it show me dentists in Anaheim unless there aren't enough in Fullerton to fill up that search result? So a lot of times it's very difficult to show up for surrounding communities, even though you're physically close. That's where PPC ads can come in. So when we design a program, what we want to do is, okay, where's your practice? Draw a big circle around that. Okay, where are most of your patients coming from? And then understand, where are you currently ranking well, or where could you be ranking well with good SEO? And where are the areas where you're probably never going to rank well for SEO because of your physical address differences? Those are the areas we want to focus on for PPC. So when you design a program, it's important to kind of get those strategies properly implemented so you don't waste a bunch of budget on things that are not going to produce results. Okay, so now let's dig into SEO. How do the search engines work, first of all? Well, one of the things that you need to understand is when Google, you do a search on Google for, you know, any topic and it returns like, you know, 3 million results in half a second, right? How in the world does it do that? Well, what's happening is the search engines are constantly 24/7 doing what we call crawling websites or indexing websites, meaning their algorithms are going through all those lines of code in your website and it's storing on its servers, you know, all those lines of code, all the images, you know, content, all that stuff. And so it's already kind of pre-analyzed all these websites. So when you do a search for something, Google is just kind of simply calling up upon analysis and work that it's already done. And so the cycle is about every 30 days, about once a month, the search engines will crawl through, will index through your website and store that information. And what it's doing every time it does that is it looks, what did we see 30 days prior to what we're seeing today? Meaning, have there been any improvements made? Have we added new content? Have we improved the code? Have we added blog posts? Have we added new pages? Have we added videos, right? So what has been done to improve this website, to continue to give us what we want? You got to feed the beast a little bit here. So because the search engines are evaluating you every 30 days, this is why SEO has to be an ongoing effort, because you're being judged on an ongoing basis every 30 days or so. So when we talk about SEO, the stuff I'm about to teach you, you can't just do it one and done. You have to kind of, some of the things you do once, like if you optimize your code, okay, that's something that you're not going to do on an ongoing basis. But there are many, many things that should be done on an ongoing basis to properly get rewarded by Google. So let's dive into this a little bit. Now, what do we need to understand about search? Well, number one, search is complicated. There are well over 200 variables that Google looks at in its algorithm to determine how high to rank your website. And as we talked about earlier, some of those variables are on page, meaning on the website itself, website code and content. And then a bunch of those variables are off page, things like directories and online reviews and social media engagement and things of that nature. So there are just many, many variables Google's looking at. But to make matters worse, Google changes the algorithm constantly, hundreds of times a year, Google's changing that algorithm. So it is literally a complicated moving target. Now, the good news is some of the fundamentals don't change a ton. You know, a lot of those fundamentals, like Google has, does, and always will want good quality, unique content. Like that's just never going to change. So some of those fundamentals are fairly solid, but there are a lot of other things that matter that change quite a bit. And so this is the challenge of an SEO agency like WEO Media, is we have a big team and they are really focused on all the industry updates and changes to make sure we can continue to keep our clients' websites ranking highly. It's a big job. The reason we talk so much about Google is Google's about two-thirds of all the search volume in North America. Bing's about 20%. Yahoo's about 10%, roughly, give or take a little bit. So we typically tend to focus on Google. That's why. Now, if you could take those over 200 variables and kind of categorize them into maybe six primary buckets of stuff, these would be six of the biggest buckets. We've got code, content, incoming links, reviews, social media, and directories. I'm going to talk about each of these in a little bit of detail, some more than others, because my goal here is to really educate you about how this stuff works. So if you are currently paying an SEO agency, you'll have a much better idea what they should be doing, and you can ask them some intelligent questions. If you're considering hiring an SEO agency, you'll have a much better idea how this stuff works and can ask some good interview questions to help you understand if you're picking a good agency. Okay, so let's get started. First one is code. What is code? I'm going to talk to you a little bit about code just because this is really an important piece. So there's something in the code called the title tag. So if you pull up a website, you'll see here at the top, we've got a little tab there. When you open your browser, you have a tab, and the text up in that tab says dentist in Austin, Texas, Dentistry and Comfort, BJ Myers. This is an older website, but the code is always the same on websites. So where does that content come from? You know, how does the search engine know what text to put up there? Well, that comes from something called a title tag. If you look at line 5 in the code here, we type exactly in the title tag in the code, and it tells the search engine, hey, here's the text I want to display up here. Now, the purpose of this title tag is really the first opportunity to tell the search engine, here's what kind of business I am, here's where I'm located, here's roughly what I provide. So it's a good initial introduction to the search engine. Hey, here's our business, right? So this is good. This is how you'd want to do it. That's thumbs up. Now, the title tag is used in other ways as well. So when you do a search and you see kind of the headline, so to speak, of the search listing, the search result, that also is the title tag. So again, if we look at the title tag, line 5 of the code, it says Bellevue Dentist, Cooley Smiles, Family and Cosmetic Dentist in Bellevue, right? That text is exactly what shows up right there in the search result. That is the title tag, right? So again, this is correct. That's how you want to do it, because we're talking about what are we? We're a dentist. Where are we? We're in Bellevue. What's our name? Cooley Smiles. So you're kind of giving those main criteria. Now, if you don't proactively put these types of things in your title tag, then Google's going to pull random content out of your website and kind of throw something up there. And maybe it's good, maybe it's not. You know, sometimes I see home, like sometimes people just call it homepage and they don't change that in the title tag. And so on a search result, you know, it will pull something other than home, but your description and everything is going to be really poorly optimized. Speaking of description, so if the title tag is that headline, what's this text then? Where does that text come from? That's kind of what we call our meta description tag. So again, from the code, line 8 on this particular website, you type in that meta description, and that text exactly is what shows up in your search results. So again, if your agency doesn't proactively write this kind of stuff into the code, it's not going to show up properly in a search result. So again, this is done correctly. That's good. There's another thing in the code called meta keywords, and I'm almost done with the code here, I promise, but it's important to teach you guys a little bit of this stuff because it's really important for getting websites ranked highly. Keywords, these are just opportunities to tell the search engine, hey, here's what we would like to rank for. Here's what we think we are relevant for. Bellevue dentist, cosmetic dentist, family dentist, and so forth, right? So those are keywords. That's fine. Now, what's interesting about a lot of the stuff I'm teaching you here is all SEO agencies know this. This is not advanced stuff right now we're talking about. But because their clients often don't understand any of this stuff, sometimes agencies will kind of pull tricks to try to fake results. So for example, this is website code on a dentist's website. I lectured at this doctor's study club years ago. And he said to me, hey, Ian, I've got an SEO agency that I've hired. You know, they say they're doing a good job. I'm getting all this website traffic, but I'm not getting any phone calls. I'm not getting any new patients. And I was like, okay, that's interesting. So what do I do? I said, well, the first thing I typically want to do is I want to look at the website code because it tells me a lot about who built the website and how well it's built. You know, I can look at the code and all the descriptions and the tags and see if the stuff's optimized or not. And in this case, what do I see here in the meta keywords? We see Christy Brinkley, Halle Berry, Zac Efron, Bradley Cooper, New Year's resolution. What's going on here? What do you guys think's happening here? Well, as you might suspect, the SEO agency in this case, they were putting keywords in the code that get a lot of search volume. So yeah, this doctor's website was getting a lot more traffic than it used to, but it's not traffic looking for a dentist, right? They're looking for celebrities and other things. And so, yeah, he was getting a lot of traffic. But as we came to find out when I analyzed his code, I showed him this and he got really upset and he fired his agency as he rightly should have. So these are the kind of things that people, games that people can play sometimes. So if you're paying an agency and you're not getting results, there's probably a reason why. It doesn't necessarily mean they're doing something nefarious like this, but they're probably not doing what they should be doing. Good SEO takes a lot of work. Now, there's another thing that matters with the content and the code. In this case, we think about our two audiences. Audience number one is the people. Number two is the search engine. So audience number one, people, what do we see here? We see an image of the waiting room. Cool. Nothing wrong with that. We see some description about our building and our lobby. Again, that's all good. Nothing wrong with all that for audience number one. Audience number two is the search engine. What does the search engine look at? Well, search engine cannot view an image, right? It doesn't have a brain and eyeballs. It's an algorithm. So all it can do is read the file name of that image. Well, the office, this image is called officeinside.jpg. Well, if the search engine's reading Office Inside, does Office Inside tell the search engine what type of business this is? Where is it located? What do they specialize in? Nothing, right? There's no useful information about this image. Now, probably whoever built this website was just a graphic designer, and they just named the image based on what it was, which makes logical sense if you don't understand search engines or you don't care about Google rankings. If you do care about Google rankings, then what you want to do is name the images on your website with keywords in them. So let's pretend this is a dentist in Seattle, Washington. It's not, but let's just pretend it is. This should say Dentist Seattle Office Inside or something like that. Every image should have keywords in it because the search engines are reading the file names. So this is done poorly. This is a missed opportunity, this example. There's another quick thing I want to point out here. This one's interesting. So I did a lecture at the Oregon Dental Conference years ago, and afterwards a doctor came up to me and he said, "Hey, Ian, I have like really bad SEO. You know, I don't even rank for my own name." And I said, "Oh, wow, that is pretty bad." And so you should always rank for your name. And so again, I looked at the code, and what I found is line 15 in his code, it said, "No index, no follow." What that means is you're basically telling that search engine, remember I said every 30 days, the search engine will index your website? Well, what this is telling the search engine is don't index my website. Don't store me in your archives. Don't show me in a search result. Literally, like, I want to be invisible. Do not show me in a search. Get out of here. Shoo. Go away, Google. That's what you're doing here when you put no index, no follow. So this is a huge problem. Now, I said to the doctor, I said, look, the good news is it should say index, comma, follow. So just have your website person delete NO and NO. So it says index, comma, follow, and you're good. You'll start ranking for your name within a matter of, you know, days or weeks. And so depending on when you get indexed. So the doctor was like, "Oh man, that's great news." He said, but why did they do that in the first place? And I said, "Well, honestly, I mean, there's no way to sugarcoat this. Like, whoever built your website doesn't know what they're doing. It's just as simple as that. The code can kill you if you don't know what you're doing, or it can be your greatest ally if you're really good at it in terms of Google rankings. But again, all this code stuff, none of this shows up on the public-facing part of the website. So the Christy Brinkley Halle Berry code, you couldn't see that on the public-facing website. The audience number one, the people, it's not on that part of the website. It's only in the code. So a lot of the stuff only exists in the code, and you don't even know it's there. And so a lot of times, you know, doctors will wonder why they're ranking so poorly, and they just have no idea how to analyze it, because frankly, it can be a little complicated. And so what I encourage people, if you're listening to this webinar right now, I'm going to give you my contact information at the end. You know, if you want us to analyze your website code, content, SEO in general, just send me an email. We'll take a look. We'll help you out with it. It's kind of interesting, I think. Okay, that's enough of code. Let's switch gears. That was kind of bucket number one was a code. Let's talk about the second bucket, which is content. Now, unlike the code, which probably, you know, you're not going to be able to do much with yourself, content you can affect and impact yourself. So when we talk about content, there are many things here that really matter. We already talked about it needs to be unique, item four on the list, right? You got to have unique content, and the more the better. Also, quantity matters, right? The number of pages, bigger websites tend to rank better than smaller websites. Also, the amount of words on a page. So if you want to rank for dental implants, for example, or, you know, Invisalign or whatever you're trying to rank for, when you have that unique page, that's the individual page for the topic with unique content, two or three sentences is not sufficient. You need to have ideally 300 to 500 words on a page of unique content in order to have an opportunity to rank. More competitive markets, you need more pages of unique content. Those are kind of some of the ballpark things. So what this means for you listening to this is if you want to improve your Google rankings, write a bunch of unique content about the services you care most about ranking for. Give that to your website company and say, "Hey, can you please upload this content to my service pages And then if they're actually doing SEO for you, even better is ask them to, you know, optimize the code and things like that. And if they're not doing SEO, still putting that content is going to be helpful, better than nothing. And that's something that you can help do yourself. The third bucket would be what we call incoming links or backlinks. Now, we look at this graphic here. Let's pretend that that's your website in the middle, okay? And all out there on the internet, there are all these other websites out there. And if I'm on one of these other websites and I click on a link on that website and it takes me over to your website, that's called a backlink or an incoming link to your website. That helps you rank better in the search result. It doesn't help them. So on your website, if you have links on your website to other websites, that's fine. You're helping their SEO, but you're not helping your own. So what you want to do, and this is one of the hardest things to do in SEO, is to get good quality backlinks placed on other people's websites that link back to yours. And these could be, you know, colleagues from dental school that maybe don't practice, you know, in a competitive, you know, geography next to you, or people potentially even, you know, your referrals if you're a specialist, or if you're a general dentist, maybe the specialist you refer to. Maybe you sponsor, you know, stuff in your community. Maybe you can get links from those companies that you support in your community. There's lots and lots of things that can be done here. But the bottom line is search engines look at incoming links a little bit like a popularity contest. If they see two websites with, you know, unique content and good code and, you know, everything's fairly similar, but one website has like 57 incoming links and the other has 7, well, Google's going to look at that and say, okay, the website that has more incoming links, more people are pointing to that website. More people are referencing that website, so it must have better content, more useful and interesting content, and therefore the websites with more backlinks tend to rank higher normally. Not always, but normally. This is a pretty important factor. Very, very few SEO companies actually do this because it is challenging. WEO Media is the only company in the dental industry that I'm aware of that actually builds backlinks for our clients. The fourth big bucket would be online reviews. Now, this is a whole separate topic in and of itself. All I'm going to say is specifically as this topic pertains to SEO performance, what helps you with SEO performance when it comes to reviews, kind of getting a steady dose of reviews on an ongoing basis is helpful. And likewise, if you can kind of engage with that content, like if somebody writes you a review, just reply, be mindful of HIPAA, you know, make sure you're not violating HIPAA and check with, you know, your HIPAA analyst or your HIPAA attorney. If you're not sure about HIPAA, a great company I like to refer people to is called Harris Biomedical out of Seattle. So if you're not sure if you can say something on a review or if it's a HIPAA violation, check with people like them. But bottom line is if you can get a good dose of steady reviews every month, it can be very helpful for your SEO performance. Social media, likewise, we can do an entire webinar, and in fact we have, on reviews and social media. All I'm going to say is, as this pertains to SEO, when it comes to social media, simply posting content on Facebook or Instagram or LinkedIn or whatever is not super helpful for your SEO. However, if it's engaging content that people actually interact with, they like it, they share it, they comment on it, they retweet it. If there's engagement like that, that actually is a strong SEO signal, and that does help your SEO performance. So if you've got, you know, good reviews happening every month, you've got engaging social media, those off-page things can help your on-page rankings. Meaning if you have good SEO from a variety of things on-page and off-page, you tend to rank really well in competitive markets. So it's not enough to just have good content and good code. You need to kind of be checking, you know, all those boxes when it comes to how do we rank for on Google search. The last of the six buckets I want to talk about are called directories, also known as citations. Well, they're slightly different, but you can kind of think of them the same way. Essentially, there are literally hundreds of these directories across the internet. What Google and the search engines do is they scour all these directories, and they're looking at your name, your phone number, your address, and in many cases, your website. If it sees differences between directories, you know, like the major ones, of course, are going to be like the search engines and the major review sites and stuff like that. But there are just, you know, hundreds of these smaller directories. You know, yellow pages and decks and all these types of things. So if it sees, for example, you know, the suite number is wrong, it's suite A here and suite B on that other site, or you've got a DMD here and a DDS there, or, you know, there's any sort of differences, the search engines look at that and say, okay, I know something is incorrect. I don't know which one of these listings necessarily is wrong and which one is correct, but I know something's wrong. So therefore, I don't have a lot of confidence in this business. So I'm going to tend to rank it a lot lower in the search result. So this is another example of off-page optimization where You could have a great website with great content, but if your directories are all screwed up, you can still have a really hard time ranking because the search engines have no confidence in where is your address? Where are you located? What is your name, right? What's the proper phone number? If it has questions about your information, you're going to rank a lot lower in the search results. So one of the very first things we do with our clients for SEO is we go through and we use a service and we go through and make sure that we scrub all the directories and get them correct and the same across all of them. Some of them you can automate, some of them you have to really go in and do it manually. We go in and do all of it. It's really important. So I'm going to show you a few case studies here to demonstrate some of the things we've talked about. So this first case study, this is a general dentist practice in Seattle, Washington. The goal was let's generate some new patient flow, right? So here's the traffic data. So what we do when we're doing SEO for clients is we track a lot of metrics and we send monthly reports which kind of show the data. So here's what the traffic looks like. So you can see there's a huge increase in traffic over 9 months. So you do the SEO, the traffic increases. So, you know, the question here is, well, did we do a good job? And the answer is, I don't know. You can't really tell by looking at traffic if we did a good job, because what if we got this traffic with Halle Berry and Zac Efron, right, and Christie Brinkley? You don't know looking at traffic if it's the right kind of traffic or not. What you really need to look at are also the conversions, meaning how many phone calls did we generate and things like that. So here's the phone call data. Now you can see the trend mimics the trend for traffic. So if the calls and the traffic have a similar type of a trend on the graph, then meaning the calls are tracking the traffic, then it's the right kind of traffic. If the traffic's going up, but the calls are flat, it's the wrong kind of traffic. Well, in this case, again, we'll go back here. There's traffic, there's calls. You can see it's very, very similar. Now, the other thing you'll notice is I'm gonna go back to traffic. Let's look at like month 9 and 10, around 2000 visitors, okay? Well, let's look at months 9 and 10 on calls, you know, a little over 200 calls. That's pretty typical. We typically see around, you know, 10 to 15% of the calls end up becoming new patients. That's pretty typical. So if you see 200 calls, I'm expecting we're going to get around 20 new patients, you know, from SEO that month, something like that. And that's in fact what happened. Another thing we look at is the conversion rate, meaning, okay, we generated X amount of traffic. How many conversions, how many potential leads did we get from that traffic? So if you divide the calls by the traffic, you can see the first few months were like 8 or 9% range. You know, not bad, not terrible, but not great. Then, you know, you make some tweaks to the website, you maybe add a video, you do some redesigns, you maybe move the location of the appointment request button, things of that nature. There's things we can do that we've learned over time to optimize the conversion rate. And so you can see, you know, month 4 and beyond, conversion rate went up. So not only does the traffic increase, but the percentage of that traffic you're converting into leads also increases. That's when you can get a really stellar performance on a program. This particular client was getting about 20 to 30 new patients a month from their digital marketing with us. They were spending about $2,500 a month. So their patient acquisition cost was about $100 to $125 a patient. And the patient data came from them. So they told us, you guys are getting us this many patients, which was great. When our clients are willing to share that data with us, we love it because it helps us understand if we're doing a good job or not. And we've been doing this long enough now with hundreds of clients. We have a pretty good idea. We're really dialed in. We know typically the patient acquisition is going to be between $100 and $150 once things are optimized. It can be a little higher than that earlier on, but once things are optimized and ranking well, the return on investment is just outstanding. Now, this next case study is more of a cautionary tale. This one's fairly interesting. This was a general dentist in the Portland, Oregon area where we're based. And their goal was, let's generate new patients. Now, I'm going to skip the traffic and go straight to the phone calls here. So what we see, what we're doing SEO, you see the first month, you know, SEO, the website hasn't been indexed yet, so not a lot of traffic and calls. So it's like, you know, maybe 15, 20 phone calls that first month. But look at month 2, already over 100 phone calls. And it just kind of keeps climbing there over the next year. Like tops out around month, you know, 14, 15, it looks like it spikes up to well over 200 calls. Now, what's interesting is in month 15, the doctor called and canceled SEO and turned off his SEO. And we were like, wow, why would you want to do that? We're generating so many calls and so many leads. And he was getting new patient flow, but he's like, well, I'm just not sure if the ROI is worth it. And so like, how could it not be worth it with so many new, I mean, unless it's the wrong kind of calls, but it wasn't. What happened was we looked at the phone call data and about 40% of the calls were going to voicemail. So here's a doctor spending a good chunk of money to do digital marketing to generate leads, but then the staff isn't answering the phone. And of the calls that they were answering, they were doing a pretty poor job of converting those calls. So the problem was not the marketing. The problem was the front desk. But the doctor didn't want to address the internal issues. And so it's easier to fire the marketing company than to try to train your staff, apparently, at least in his mind. And so what happened was, now, the reason I say all that, I want to show you what happens when you turn off SEO. So notice at month 15, SEO is turned off. And look what happens to the phone calls. Just boom, it just drops off a cliff. Why does this happen? Because remember, search engines are indexing and they're judging you every 30 days. So if you're in a competitive market like Portland and you stop, your rankings are going to drop pretty fast. And so you can see from month 15 to about month 18, we go from over 150 calls a month to under 50. So over 100 calls per month drop. And then he kind of hovers in this 50 call range for a few months. And then after that, by month 22, right back down to where he started. So interesting about this, here's a practice that did 15 months of high quality SEO. And they turned it off. And 7 months later, literally, it was as if they never did SEO at all. Even though the website had good code and good content, because nothing was been done on an ongoing basis, Google stopped rewarding it. Other websites around them kind of kept doing things. And so he just kind of kept getting passed and passed and passed by other websites who remained active with their SEO, and his phone calls just dropped to the floor. So this is why when people say, can I stop doing SEO after a little while? I tell them no. And I love this graph because it really demonstrates visually, powerfully, I think, you know, the impact of stopping versus starting SEO. So moral of the story, right? Number one, answer the phone. You know, if you're paying a marketing company to generate leads, make sure you're paying really close attention to your phones. And look at the data. You know, there are great software packages out there to analyze. My favorite is called Patient Prism, if you've ever heard of them. I think it's just patientprism.com. Look them up. They're fantastic. They have really cool software that analyzes phone calls, especially new patient calls. And it gets into a bunch of details on how you can improve that performance. But main thing I'm caring about is, are you tracking the data? Do you know how many calls you're getting and how many are answered versus going to voicemail? That's a super important metric. If you're spending dollars on marketing and you don't know that, you need to know that, right? That's super important. The other moral of the story here is, you know, don't turn off SEO. If it's working, don't turn it off. How do you know if it's working? Because your rankings are getting better, traffic's going up. Ultimately, how you know, of course, are the leads are going up. You're getting more calls, live chats, appointment requests, that kind of thing. Now, if you're paying for SEO and those things aren't happening, you're not getting calls like the Halle Berry, Zac Efron doctor, well, yeah, then go ahead and cancel that. You're not losing anything there. But once you find an agency that's actually good and is getting results, work with them, track the data, train your staff. If you can do those things, you can get an incredible performance on your return on investment. Last case study. This is an oral surgeon. So the first two are general dentists. Now we're switching to a specialist. This is an oral surgeon in the Phoenix, Arizona area. His goal was to generate more dental implant patients. And, you know, we do a lot of work with specialists. I mean, most of our clients are GPs, just like the market is, but we have hundreds of specialty clients, you know, surgeons and periodontists and so forth. And in the olden days, you know, I'd get a lot of pushback from specialists. Oh, you know, I'm referral driven. This marketing stuff really doesn't matter for me. I focus on my referrals. And that was all well and good 10 years ago, maybe even 5 years ago to a lesser degree. But nowadays, you know, there's just a lot more specialists who are interested in at least a portion of their patient base coming from a more proactive digital marketing effort. And so this one is a great example of what happens when specialists kind of wake up to the fact that, hey, this can work for them. So the starting position for this oral surgeon, he really wasn't doing a lot with digital marketing, which is not uncommon for surgeons, wasn't ranking particularly well for major search terms like dental implants and things like that. And he had really no online reviews, one Google review, nothing on Health Grades, 9 reviews on Facebook. So what did we do? Well, we built him a nice new website, did SEO and PPC, did reviews, did videos, right? 5 of the 6 pillars we did for him. We didn't do social media. He didn't want that. He had a person in-house doing it. That's fine. But we were doing 5 of the 6 pillars. And he was spending about $2,000 a month at that time. His budget's gone up since then. So like I said, here's this kind of starting position with reviews. After about a year, look how many reviews we're able to generate. I'm using our review software called Wheel Reviews. So huge increase, right? We went from 10 reviews on the major review sites to 139. That had a pretty big impact, not only helping his rankings, but also helping with the conversion. Because one of the things that patients are looking at is, they look at your website, yes, but they're going to look at your reviews. You know, before they pick up the phone and call, they're going to look at your Google reviews, maybe your Facebook and Health Grades, maybe Yelp, whatever. But the reviews is an important piece of what happened here. So overall results, like we did SEO and PPC and all these things. So we got him ranking on page 1 for all the primary search terms. consistently, he was averaging adding about 10 reviews a month, which was really nice. Now, this is the data, this green here, this is the data from the doctor and his office manager. They analyzed the data and gave us this information. They said, okay, for this calendar year, you guys got us 85 new patients, which was over doubling the number of dental implant patients. Now, this was an established oral surgeon who had been practicing for well over a decade in his market. He had a very mature referral base, a mature practice. This was not a guy who had just started doing dental implants last year. He already did a pretty healthy volume of dental implants. We more than doubled it from digital marketing alone. That was huge. What about the dollars? Well, he spent about $2,000 a month, 24 grand a year, and we generated well over $250,000 in revenue, which is about an 11 times return on investment. So one of the ways you think about marketing is, if I give you a dollar, Mr. Marketing Company, what are you giving me back? And in this case, this guy gave We Media a dollar, and we gave him $11 back, right, in revenue. Now, obviously, he's got costs and expenses, so his profit isn't 11x, but it's a really good profit margin when you do math. So this is what can happen for specialists if they pay attention to this stuff and hire a good agency. The results can be outstanding. Okay, that's SEO. Now I want to switch gears and let's talk about PPC, pay per click. Okay, now we're talking about the blue up at the top again. Now, where SEO is more of a marathon, you 6 months, 9 months, 12 months before you really start seeing the fruits of the labor sometimes. Pay-per-click ads are immediate, right? They're a sprint. You turn it on, you're immediately getting clicks. Hopefully, you're immediately getting calls. As we talked about earlier, you know, where you're ranking poorly organically or not ranking well yet because SEO hasn't had time to get you there, that's where PPC ads can make a lot of sense. One of the things that I see commonly done wrong on PPC ads is you'll have an ad. Again, I'll just stick with the dental implant theme here. Doing dental implants, click on my ad for dental implants, and it goes to the homepage of the website that's not about dental implants. When that happens, people see that and say, well, this isn't about dental implants, and they leave. And so you end up getting a poor result. So make sure whatever your ad topic is links to a page specifically about that topic. You'll get a better conversion rate, meaning if I have an ad about dental implants, it better link to a page specifically about dental implants. And obviously, it should have a call to action. And I'll show you kind of the anatomy of what a PPC landing page would look like in a minute. Now, what are the hot buttons? Meaning, what are the hot button is a decision-making criteria, right? So what are the things, if I'm a patient and I'm considering hiring, looking for a new dentist, what are those hot buttons? What are those decision-making criteria? Well, you know, I think all of us could come up with this list, right? Expertise and experience of the doctor of the practice. Convenient, is it located near me, you know, or is it a far drive across town? You know, technology, is it a modern practice? Does it look like they're kind of, you know, have their stuff together, or is it really kind of dated and dingy looking with old stuff? Like that's a factor. Safety, especially in the era of COVID, you know, is safety a concern? What about financing options, right? If you're offering more expensive elective stuff like, you know, veneers, implants, ortho, you know, those types of things, sleep, those are expensive procedures. So it's good to offer financing options. So do you talk about that? Do you educate your patients on all these hot buttons? What about price? Notice I have a question mark next to price. The reason I have a question mark next to price is, yes, it's absolutely a hot button, no question, certainly one of the bigger hot buttons. However, I generally do not recommend advertising on price. If you want to have a new patient special, you know, $99 exam next week, that's fine. There's no problem with that. But I'm talking about like, if you advertise the price of your implants, of your ortho, of those types of things, generally, if you're doing that, it's because it's probably lower priced to get people's attention, and it really erodes margins. What I much prefer is to focus on the other hot buttons. Let's build confidence. Let's get the patient excited about coming here because of the technology and our experience and the patient outcomes and the patient testimonials. Let's get them here because of that, and then they'll pay a fair value for a quality service. If you compete on price, then it's really a race to the bottom. You're going to erode margins. And price shoppers tend to not be loyal because they're really focusing on price and not experience. So my recommendation is, if I was a dentist, if I was in your shoes, I would not advertise on price. But I mean, if your strategy is like, hey, we're the low-cost leader in our town, cool. If that's your strategy, go for it. You'll get a lot of clicks, but you probably won't get loyal patients. Okay. Now, when you're running a pay-per-click campaign, some of the important metrics to consider are these five. There are others, but these are the things that I think if you're hiring an agency to do this, these are things you want to have a little bit of an understanding about, okay? The first one's called bounce rate. What is that? Well, okay, let's say we go back to my dental implant ad, right? I click on the dental implant ad, it goes to your homepage, like, oh, that's not what I'm looking for, and I leave. So if somebody clicks on it on a link and then they leave that page within a few seconds, that's called a bounce. The number of times that happens out of 100 visitors to your website is your bounce rate. So out of 100 visitors, if 73 visitors left your website really quickly, then you have a 73% bounce rate, for example. So the higher your bounce rate, that means tells the search engine if you have a high bounce rate, your content is either not engaging or it's not about the right topic or your website loads too slowly. Like there's some sort of user problem here because you have a high bounce rate. So that informs other metrics that are more meaningful. So if you have a high bounce rate, what happens is you tend to get a low quality score. Well, what does that mean? So these ads typically are scored on a scale of 1 to 10, 1 being terrible, 10 being great. So let's say month one of your campaign, Google gives you a score, a quality score of a 7, and they're charging you a cost per click of $10 a click. Okay. The second month, this is Google says, oh, wow, your bounce rate is pretty high. So we're going to drop that quality score from a 7 down to a 5. And if your quality score drops, what that typically means is they're going to charge you more money. Your cost per click is going to go up. So you're instead of $10 a click, now we're going to charge you $12 a click this month. So for the same budget, you're going to get fewer clicks. Now, why does Google do that? If you think about fundamentally, how does Google win and dominate the search engine wars? Because they provide the best search results. They provide the best content. So when you do a search, Google does the best job of returning search results that people want to engage with, that people want to click on and stay on, meaning low bounce. So if you're serving up ads on Google's platform that have a high bounce rate, you're hurting Google. You're hurting their business model. You're providing content that is not good, and that's not their brand. That's not how they dominate. So what they're going to do is they're going to punish you for having a bad ad. They're going to give you a low quality score. They're going to increase your cost per click. They're basically de-incentivizing you to use their platform. If you suck at doing this, go use Bing and Yahoo. That's what they'd like you to do, right? Now, conversely, if your bounce rate is good and gets better, and your quality score then would get better, and your cost per click would actually drop. So if your cost per click was $10 the first month, maybe it's $8 the second and third month because Google says, hey, you have good quality content. Your bounce rate's low, your quality score is high. We're going to reward you. We want to keep you on our platform because you know what you're doing. And so they'll reward you with a lower cost per click, meaning you'll get more clicks for the same budget month over month. A good agency will be able to more than pay for their management fee by the savings and cost per click. We do this all the time at WEO. We charge a reasonable management fee, and the massive savings we get on cost per click pay for our management fee. So not only does the doctor not have to spend his or her time on this stuff, we're going to get a much better result anyways. So those are kind of the first three metrics that are pretty important. Ultimately, though, cost per click doesn't mean much if you don't get leads, right? So conversion, of course, is important. How many appointment requests, how many live chats, how many phone calls, right? So we got to look at those conversions. And then you can look at another metric called cost per conversion, which I don't have on here, but that's also an interesting metric. So let's shift gears. So let's look at the anatomy of an ad, right? With SEO, we broke down, websites and code and content and all that. Let's do a little bit of breakdown on an ad. So when we talk about dental implants, nobody does more dental implant advertising and placement than ClearChoice. I think probably everybody on this webinar knows who ClearChoice is. So let's look at one of their ads. The first thing I've highlighted here, the headline of the ad, same day dental implants, one price for entire treatment. Sounds like a couple of big hot buttons, right? Same day. Well, that must be a hot button. I don't want to have to come back repeatedly or go to multiple offices, right? One price. I don't want to get a price, a bill from the lab and a bill from the specialist and a bill from the restorative doctor. I want one price done on one day. That's their headline. So those must be important hot buttons. What else? No more discomfort, right? A lot of times these ads will show patients eating an apple or eating a steak because, frankly, they can't do that if they're a dentalist or have poor dentition, right? Eat freely again, similar hot button. No hidden fees, right? Gets back to that one price for the treatment. What else? Free CT scan. Now, the general public may not know what that means. You and I know what that means. But a patient who is researching dental implants probably is going to figure out what that means and say, hey, that sounds like a good thing. And ultimately, what about financing options, right? We know dental implants are not cheap. And a lot of people don't have, thousands of dollars just burning a hole in their pocket that they want to go out and spend on implants. So providing financing options is helpful. And so, especially if you're talking like a full arch, you're talking $25,000, it's like buying a car. right? You need to offer financing options, obviously, for these things. So these are some of the hot buttons that Clear Choice has put in their ad. And when you click on this ad and go to their webpage, it further educates on these topics. Now, this is a landing page for one of our clients. I'm just going to kind of show you some of the typical anatomy of a landing page. So maybe at the top, you've got like an initial call to action, you know, button, schedule your consultation with us, right? Below that, we've got like a video. So videos are great on landing pages because they can educate potential people checking you out and they can get a feel for the practice, for the doctors, for the philosophy, all that kind of thing. So videos are really helpful for improving your conversion rate on landing pages. If the video doesn't get them, well, what else? Well, we got benefits of dental implants, so they can kind of read about the benefits. What about the experience of the doctors, right? Well, let's put that in there too. As we scroll further down the page, let's add some patient testimonials. Now, these are text. If we had video testimonials, that would be even much better. I love video testimonials, especially when it's cosmetic and implants and things like that. And below that, we've got more, you know, educational frequently asked questions. And then again, another call to action. A lot of times too, it's nice if you could have like a live chat happening on the screen, things like that. So these are the typical things you would want to have on a pay-per-click landing page. Now, at WEO Media, there's another thing. We've recently pioneered a brand new service. We call this service Patient Pipeline. This is a really cool service. It's a really kind of an expansion of typical pay-per-click. In a normal pay-per-click campaign, kind of the first three check marks here, we make the contact, you generate the lead, collect their contact information. What we've added, what's really interesting with Patient Pipeline, is we custom build a sales CRM. It's a software that we license, and we custom set it up for each practice. And what happens is when the ads run, the contact information is collected, and that information drops into a sales CRM that's open 24/7 on the practice website. So whenever the practice, not on their website, it's open on their computers in their office. And so when they're in the office, they can have the screen up and they can see in real time just patient leads just dropping into that CRM, and they can follow up on them immediately. So this is a really, really powerful service. So the flow is basically we generate the lead, we qualify the lead, and then capture their contact information. Doing this on, you know, Google, Facebook, Health Grades, Instagram, there's lots of places we can generate these leads. The leads then dump into this patient pipeline software. And what's really cool about this is, you know, you can see the various columns here, right? So we've called them once, we've called them twice, all the way up to a fifth call. If you don't connect with them after five calls, then we can go ahead and archive it. You can archive it. But as soon as you make contact, then you move it over into the appointment column. And then you can see, okay, either they no-showed or an actual sale happened. And so what's really cool about this is it's really transparent. The doctors and staff can quickly see, you know, all the leads that are being generated, and then how many patients are converting, and ultimately what was the revenue generated from that program. So this is more of an advanced program. It's typically a higher budget deal. Entry level starts at about $5,000 a month because we need to generate enough clicks. But the return on investment is outstanding. So this is one of our clients who agreed to share all their production data with us. And what's really cool about this is like the very first month, right out of the gate, already a 5x return on investment. Look at month two, 20 times. Month three, 13 times. Now, month four is interesting. They lost a key staff person that month who was the person following up on the leads. And so the return on investment dropped quite a bit that month because of that. But then they got somebody back in, and then you can see month five and six are kind of back on track. So overall, like the return on investment is incredible from this program if you have people who can follow up on the leads. That's kind of the key here. Okay, so that's SEO and PPC. Let me kind of move into some recommendations here, and then we'll wrap it up. One of the things that's important to understand when you're talking about a digital marketing program is what kind of budget should I be spending? How much should I invest in my marketing? So there's an organization called the Academy of Dental CPAs. It's adcpa.org. It's a couple dozen dental CPA firms. They're all independently owned and operated, collectively representing over 9,000 dental practices around the country. So they collectively have a ton of financial data on how dental practices perform. And so I was invited to speak at their annual meeting a few years ago, and I asked many of them, I said, well, of the practices that you guys have that are doing really well, you know, that are growing, that are profitable, what are they spending on marketing? And it was typically between 3 to 5%, sometimes up to 7% of revenue. So if it's a $1 million practice in revenue per year, they were spending $30,000 to $70,000 on marketing. Now the average dentist spends less than 1%, and that's why most dentists don't grow that much. But for practices, if you spend money on good marketing, it can have a tremendous return on investment. Simply spending on marketing is no guarantee of results if the marketing itself isn't effective, or if the practice is not good at following up on the leads. What does that mean in terms of dollars? You know, typically $1,500 to $5,000 a month is kind of a good solid range. Most of our clients fall into that range. And in that range, it's generally enough budget where we can be kind of doing all six of the pillars and really getting effective results and good return on investment. When we're talking about general dentists, the typical patient acquisition cost is between $100 and $150 per patient. A typical general dentist patient is worth about $800 to $1,200 a year to a practice. So the return on investment is really good. And if you can maintain that patient, retain them for years and years, you're only paying acquisition costs once, but you can hopefully get that revenue for years and years. And hopefully you'll even get referrals from them, right? Which is even better acquisition costs. So the return can be really good if you dial in the marketing. One thing I'll mention here quickly too is DIY, do it yourself versus an agency. If you're going to hire somebody to do pay-per-click, I would highly recommend that you make sure they're a Google certified partner agency. We've been one for many, many years. The thing here is people go through a series of testing protocols with Google to kind of get this stamp of approval, so to speak, from Google. So anybody who's a Google partner, they're going to be really good typically, and they're typically going to be able to save you a fair amount of money on your management fees or your cost per click and things like that. So I always recommend, like, this is one of those things you should delegate and not try to do yourself. There's a lot of little tricks to the trade that you learn over time. So let me go through some takeaways and we'll wrap up here. So number one here, we want to make sure we're investing in real SEO, right? What do I mean by that, right? They're writing unique content. They're optimizing your code. They're building backlinks. They're helping you get reviews and these types of things. And ultimately, real SEO should be producing an increase in traffic and phone calls and things of that nature. If you're not getting as much PPC or new patient flow as you'd like from SEO alone, consider pay-per-click ads for additional lead flow, right? They can be very effective. Track your metrics, right? Make sure you're tracking phone calls, how many are answered versus unanswered, traffic, and other key performance indicators, depending on what marketing you're doing. I would recommend scheduling regular phone calls with your agency, definitely having regular meetings with your internal marketing. So whoever is in charge of your marketing internally, whether it's a coordinator or a front office person or whatever, marketing director, you know, have regular meetings with those people and review your metrics, review your performance. But bring in your agency, you know, have a meeting with your agency once a month, every other month, once a quarter, whatever is appropriate for your cadence. But make sure that you're involving them and treat them as a partner. If you treat them just simply as a vendor where you're paying money, you're probably not going to get good results. But if you treat them as more of a partner where you talk with them and collaborate with them and share feedback, that can produce really good results. One thing I always want to mention here, and I mentioned this briefly a little bit earlier, if you would like us to analyze your website, your SEO, your digital marketing in general, send us an email, info@weamedia.com. I'm happy to do that. I'll make sure one of my consultants gets assigned to it. We do a really detailed analysis. It's not a big sales pitch. We like to educate. So what we'll do is we'll show you, here's everything we found in our research. Here's what's going good. Here's maybe opportunities for things that could be improved. And of course, if you'd like to use us, we would love to work with you, but we're not going to badger you and pester you. We're going to kind of educate you. And if you'd like to use us, well, that's fantastic. So I'm going to leave my contact information up here for a minute. If you have questions, you know, feel free to send me an email, send me a text message. That's totally fine. I will definitely get back to you shortly, usually within a day or two at the most. I'll get back to you on stuff. Happy to answer any of your questions. So I hope you got some good information today. I hope you really found this information, this content useful. Hopefully you can implement some of this right away yourselves. And like I said earlier, if you are hiring an agency, hopefully you can use a lot of this information to better educate yourself on picking a good agency, making that right choice. So anyway, I want to thank everyone for attending today. We will have future webinars. So if you heard about us from our newsletter, cool. We always advertise it in our newsletter. If you are not on our newsletter, go to our website at weamedia.com. You can sign up, register for the newsletter, and then you'll get notified about future webinars. So hope you've got some good information, and I want to thank you all for joining today. Take care.